Hey Andrew, how are you today?
I'm good, Trevor. How are you?
Hey, I'm good, thanks. We have a couple customers that have been asking about HL7 lately, and I'm wondering if you can help demystify HL7 and talk about some of the core concepts of HL7.
Absolutely. I'd love to. Let me share my screen.
Thanks.
What is HL7? Well, HL7 stands for Health Level 7. It is a standardized way to share healthcare data between healthcare providers and systems. This data is shared in the form of HL7 messages. It removes the need for applications to require software to convert this data or the need to send physical paper copies. Each message contains various standardized segments that contain clinical, financial, and administrative data. But why does HL7 even exist? Before HL7 was created, it was difficult to move collected data across an individual healthcare system's technology stack. And we can think of this problem like languages. Each application at the time within a hospital's IT stack spoke a different language. It would be up to the individual hospital's team to create a common language for these internal systems. That, in and of itself, could be a large task without expanding the scope to have one hospital system then communicate to an entirely different one. In 1989, a nonprofit organization was formed called Health Level 7 International. This organization was responsible for the creation of HL7 and since has managed its various updates. How does HL7 work? Well, there are roughly seven steps to an HL7 message lifecycle. The first step would be creation. Just like writing a letter, the HL7 message is created by a healthcare software system. This could be a hospital's electronic health record system when a doctor inputs information like a patient's test results or medication details. Step two is packaging. Once the message is created, it's packaged up in a specific format that other systems can understand. This format follows the HL7 standards, which ensure that all the important details are included and organized correctly. Step three is sending. After the message is packaged, it's sent out kind of like dropping a letter in the mailbox. Instead of using mail, however, it travels over computer networks. This could be within the same hospital system, to another hospital system, or to a specialist's office. Step four is receiving. The receiving system, like another hospital's EHR, gets the message. It's like someone opening their mailbox and finding your letter. This system checks the message is in the right format and hasn't been tampered with during its journey. Step five is processing. Once the message is confirmed to be correct and safe, the receiving system processes it. This involves reading the information in the message and updating their records with the new data, such as patient history or new treatment details. Step six can be optional. It would be a response step. Sometimes the receiving system needs to send back a response. This could be a confirmation that the message was received and processed, or it might be a request for more information if something wasn't clear. And finally, step seven is archiving. After everything is finished, both the sending and receiving systems often keep a copy of the message for their records. This is important for keeping track of what was communicated and when, just like saving copies of important letters for your records. And ultimately, why is understanding this process important? When troubleshooting an issue regarding HL7, there are two primary avenues to investigate. One would be the contents of an HL7 message. This could take the form of an HL7 message missing data that is required for it to be processed. The other is the workflow or lifecycle of an HL7 message, like we just discussed. In order to begin to troubleshoot HL7, we need to be able to dissect the workflow and check out which step the HL7 message may be failing. Is the error within the receiving system at the processing step, or is there an issue with the way the sending step is generating the HL7 message? Understanding the flow of HL7 will help you to narrow the scope of investigation if an issue should occur. We could talk for another three question corners about the specifics of HL7 messages, how they are processed by system, the customization of specific messages for operational purposes, etc. But hopefully, this quick overview of the general life cycle of an HL7 message allows you to better understand how this system works and more easily isolate and troubleshoot an issue if it occurs.
Thanks for watching. Make sure to hit that subscribe button and give us a thumbs up. If you have a question that you would like answered on an upcoming question corner, please leave a comment below.